At Ping, we don't make women's clubs. We make clubs for women. They're custom made to make the game easier. The new Ping GLE3 family. Give your game the attention it deserves.
We're here at the Sports Technology Institute at Loughborough University. We've been able to bag 5 days access to use their R&D robot. So in this video, we're going to show you how 28 different golf balls compare and help you pick the best golf ball for your game. Let's get started by having a look at how we've actually done it. Right, we've snuck off and found some quiet space here at Loughborough University, so we can tell you all about how we've actually done this test. Now, please don't feel that you need to watch the entirety of the video. Just use the timestamps below to jump to the bits that you really want to know about. But in the interest of transparency, this is how we've actually done it. Let's get started by having a look at the robot. It's a Japanese robot, and it cost $100,000 20 years ago. The university specifically chose this model because it's a three-axis robot. That basically means that you can mimic the chest rotation, wrist cock, and also the rotation of the shaft axis as you come into impact. So essentially, you're able to mimic a real golfer's swing. Now, over the last few years, the university have been working very, very closely with Ping, and they've basically mapped lots and lots of golfers' swings. So for this test, we're actually using the data that's been created for them. So we are actually using real golfers' swings when we're swinging the driver, the iron, and the wedge, which is really, really cool. I personally really like the way that the robot starts from a dress. It doesn't start from halfway back like the Golf Labs robot. And also, there's no pause at the top, so you get the natural loading of the shaft. So essentially, this robot swings more like a real golfer than the robot that we've used previously. It swings between 5 miles an hour and 130 miles an hour, so pretty much we can replicate any golfer's swing here. So that's the robot. These are the experts that have actually done it for us. We've got Dr. Jonathan Roberts over here. He's the senior lecturer at Loughborough University Sports Technology Institute. He's worked at the uni for 25 years, and during that time, he's worked with the likes of Callaway, Nike, and now Ping. And I really like the way that he's been involved with designing the World Cup football over the last 20 years as well. The guy that's actually used the robot most for us is Rory England, but he's a PhD researcher at Loughborough University. And I love the fact that he is a former TG reader, and that was why he used to buy the magazine to get knowledge like we're producing in this test. And I guess we should really cover off, why have we chosen to use Loughborough University? Well, one, it's only 1 hour's drive down the road from the TG office, which is really, really useful. But most importantly, Loughborough is known as the leading sports technology university in the world. So it made perfect sense to use this location. Okay, that's the robot and the experts. Let's wind this forward. Let's have a look at the clubs, the launch monitor, and the golf balls that we've used. Right, this whole test has been designed to bring you the most amount of relevant information that we possibly can do. So we've had the robot swing at a moderate, a mid, and a fast pace. So that basically means the moderate is at 85 miles an hour. And to ensure that we get sort of consistent data with somebody that would normally be swinging at that pace, we've also used a club which would normally be fitted to that type of golfer. So we've used the Ping G430 Max at 12 degrees with an R-flex shaft. Whereas at 100 miles an hour, we're still using the same driver, but at 10.5 degrees with a stiff flex shaft. And then at 115 miles an hour, we're using a 9-degree Ping G430 LST driver with an X-flex Ping Tour 2.0 chrome shaft. Now, really worthwhile just mentioning here that the average speed of a driver is 92 to 93 miles an hour. Moving on to the iron. So we've used the Ping I230 iron, and we've swung it at 80 miles an hour, which pretty much is a mid speed with the 7-iron. And then moving on to the pitching wedge, we've swung that at 74 miles an hour, and it's the Ping I230, again with exactly the same shaft that we have used in the 7-iron. So all of that is geared to giving you the data that is likely to match your game. Just moving on, launch monitor. We've tested everything indoors. We haven't hit any balls down a range, and experience basically tells us that when you start to hit balls down a range and you're using a TrackMan, any wind, any difference that happens down the range, you end up getting in your data. So the experts at Loughborough University, they recommended testing indoors because it's a very, very controlled environment. We've created a huge amount of data. You've got 19 different basic metrics from every single shot that's hit. And we've chosen this particular launch monitor because it's a standard within the golf industry, not just with, you know, sort of top players, but also in R&D departments as well. And we've hit 12 shots from every location. So with each ball from each location, which basically means that each ball was only hit once. And to us, that's really, really important, because if you have a bad ball, which you then collect and reuse again for the next test and the next test and the next test, that ball contaminates all of your data. Whereas by hitting each ball once, we're just boxing down the effect that any bad ball could possibly have on our data. The test was broken down into sets of three. So we didn't just test one dozen at the start and then work our way through. It was actually randomized. And that basically means that we don't have any 4 or 5 hour gap between the first dozen and the last dozen. You've got different threes coming through all the time. So this is the best possible data that we could really, really create. Okay, that's loads on the clubs and the launch monitor. Let's have a look at the golf balls that we've tested. Okay, how did we actually choose which balls to include within this test? Well, it's an incredibly tough choice. And time on an R&D robot is very, very expensive. So we know it's just not possible to include every single golf ball on the market. We ran a robot test back in 2019, and we ran it out at PXG in Arizona. And during that week, we tested 22 different models of golf ball. We spoke to Loughborough University and they felt that they could handle 25 within the space of a week. But when it came up to us creating a shortlist, we really couldn't narrow that shortlist down any further than 28 different models. So we've tested 28 different golf balls in this test. And the reason why we couldn't narrow the choice anymore was because we really wanted to show you the really important choices that you're making. So how does a X-style tour ball compare against a three-piece tour-level golf ball, or a four-piece ball, or a five-piece ball? We really wanted to show you about some of the balls that claim to be like a Pro V1, so maybe something like the PXG Extreme and the Kirkland Signature, about how they compare against the Pro V1. But also, we really wanted to show the models which have really sprung up over the last sort of 2, 3, 4 years, which are aimed at club golfers, so the Eurofay models. How do they compare against a tour level golf ball, but also how do they compare against a two-piece less expensive golf ball? Because we know lots of people buy on budget, and we really wanted to show in this test what's put on the line between buying a two-piece ball and a three-piece ball, because there's a vast amount of price difference. So with all that in mind, we've picked 28 different models which we feel are geared to giving you the most relevant information to the biggest biggest golf ball models that are sold out there in the marketplace. So let's have a look at which golf balls made the cut. Let's have a look at the two-piece models. So there's only 5 two-piece models involved in this test. The thing that stands out to me is there's a huge amount of price difference between a number of the balls. So the Pinnacle Rush per ball is very, very much cheaper. One thing that I would say about this is the Callaway, so the Super Soft, is one of the best-selling balls out there in the marketplace. I know in the US last year, they absolutely bossed the market. So there's some very, very big models in here. Moving on to the three-piece balls. Now, there's pretty much 2 different categories of three-piece balls. So we have the models that we've mentioned earlier, the club golfer, urethane covered balls, and then also the premium tour level balls. So really important to know sort of where you sit in the marketplace, you know, and where you should be looking. Again, a huge amount of price difference here. So some of the most expensive being the Callaways, you've got Bridgestones, the Callaway Chrome Soft, whereas the cheapest, just looking at the Kirkland, so the Signature, £1.37 a ball, which is really, really well priced. Just to cover off the rest of those, you've got the Titleist Pro V one at there, £4.17, you know, so there is a huge amount of price difference here. Winding that forward onto the four-piece golf balls. So you've got the five different models, and these are the X-style models plus the Wilson Staff. And again, my eye is drawn immediately to the different price range. And probably really worthwhile pointing out that the Maxfli-Tour-X is the only ball in the category, really, which is aimed at club golfers, as it's not played on tour. And moving that on to the five-piece balls, it's only TaylorMade that make the five-piece balls, and I'll explain in a moment why they're five-piece. But you know, like the rest of the premium tour-level models, they do cost a little bit more. Okay, let's wind this forward and let's have a look at the different constructions and what they mean to you. Two, three, four, or five-piece golf balls. Let's see if we can help you choose which is going to be best for your game. Starting with the two-piece golf balls, these are the least expensive golf balls that you will find in the marketplace. In the middle, there's a really big core, and then wrapped around that is quite a thick cover. Looking at the cover material, it is a less expensive cover material compared to what you'll find in the three, four-piece and five-piece golf balls. Typically, it's made out of ionomer, whereas the other balls are made out of urethane. And basically, this two-piece style of golf ball has had a reputation in the past for just being very long, very low spin, very hard. When we did our golf balls test back in 2019, we really found that these models have actually moved on quite a bit. So there are options to be sort of longer distance balls, lower spinning balls, and also softer, more feel golf balls within this single category. Very often, the two-piece market offers you a blend of performance and affordability. So frequently, they are the best choice for a lot of club golfers, especially if you're prone to losing quite a few golf balls. If we move on to the three-piece club golfer golf balls, these are the modern golf ball, in my opinion. Basically, it's a category which has sprung up over the last 5 or 6 years. And it basically takes all the good traits from three, four, and five-piece golf balls and puts them into a package that's going to work at slightly lower swing speeds. So if you're an average club golfer, this is a really good option. You've got a urethane or a hybrid cover, which is very much like you would get on the tour-level balls over here. Essentially, the core is shrunk. You have a mantle layer that goes around the outside of that, and then the cover's really, really thin on the outside. And the cover's really thin because we want it to bite into the grooves of wedges so you get maximum spin green side. Just moving on to the three-piece tour level balls. Now, you would have seen on some previous slides that we mentioned about the Maxfli golf balls, and we've put those into the category of club golfer, because they are not, they're not played on tour, and yet they will try to give you the benefits of the tour level three and four piece golf balls over here. So there's a lot of variation within these categories. Essentially, the three piece tour level ball is going to be firmer than your club golfer golf balls over here. You usually get more greenside spin out of them, most definitely than what you would out of the two piece ball, but very often from my experience from the three-piece club golfer ball as well. Really interestingly, Srixon and Bridgestone only make three-piece golf balls at the tour level range. So that basically means that Srixon and Bridgestone, they don't feel like they need to make a four-piece golf ball to give you the performance traits that you want, whether you're looking for more wedge spin, lower driver spin. They feel that they can do all of that within the three-piece construction. Moving on to the four-piece construction. So Traditionally, this was an area whereby that brands would create balls that were lower spin than what you'd get in the three-piece tour category. And they were aimed at distance really aimed at higher speed players. But things have changed a huge amount within this category. So if you've typically played a Pro V1 blindly for years and completely ignored the Pro V1 X, you might well find nowadays that the traits from the Pro V1X will better suit you than what the Pro V1 will do. So the traits and the benefits have changed a lot within this category over the last few years. So choose really carefully if you're buying golf balls within this category to make sure you get the ball that really, really suits you. Moving on to five-piece, so the TaylorMade TP5X and the TP5. TaylorMade pretty much are the only company that make tour level five-piece golf balls, and I love the story about why they do. So they say that by having more layers, they've got more levers to pull and more knobs to twist and dial in performance, depending on whether they want higher spin, higher launch, you know, firmer feel. And they can do that from having the five layers better than they can with a three or a four-piece construction. So what I would say within the category, you know, five-piece, you do get different feeling golf balls. So the TP5, slightly softer, where the TP5X, slightly firmer. They will give you slightly different performance traits as well. So you do need to know what you're buying. Okay, loads of information there. Let's get back. Let's have a look and see how the testing's getting on. Right, that's 5 days worth of testing complete. We're going to head home and have a look at the data. We'll see you on the other side. Right, we're back at the TG HQ just outside of Peterborough, and I've spent the last week going over all this data and trying to make sense of it. Now, first thing that I'd say to you is that I was once told that stats and data, they are facts, but how you choose to interpret them, that becomes opinion. So if you really want to use our data, our stats, to come up with your own opinions, we really don't have a problem with that. If you feel like we flick through these slides way too quickly and you want to be able to study them much, much more closely, then please go and view them on our website, because everything we show you here will be on the website. So where do we start? Well, let's start by having a look at the 85 mile an hour driver swing speed. And what really stands out to me just by looking at this is there's only 5 yards worth of difference between the longest and the shortest ball. So that's not a huge amount. So you're not going to do any harm to your game by choosing the wrong ball here. But what you can do is really dial into the ball, which is going to help you with irons and wedges later on in this test. What really stands out to me is the top four balls. So the longest four, they've all got soft in their name. So if you've heard that soft balls are slow golf balls, I wouldn't disagree with that. But are they long golf balls? Are they short golf balls? They're certainly not short, not based on this data here. So if you want to look at the fastest golf balls, you will find here that they are the firmer models. So firm does mean fast. We've got the numbers here. And then back here, so the Wilson Staff model was the fastest. What I haven't really covered off yet is down here at the bottom, we've got the test averages. So 192.4 yards was the test average. Anything above there is above average. Anything below there is below average. And then right over there at the end, you've got the shot area. So what we've done this time, we've looked at the longest shot, the amount of distance back to the shortest shot, the furthest left and the furthest right, and that basically gives us a shot area. So when we put together the driver, the iron, the wedge information, we're going to be able to tell you about the most accurate golf ball out there. There's only nearly 750 RPM of spin difference between the lowest spinning and the highest spinning, which was the TP5, which is quite a bit of difference. So my personal feeling is, yes, okay, the Super Soft is a very low spin golf ball. It's a long golf ball. But I'd be a little bit worried if you were a very slow swing speed player. Low spin, you know, the golf ball's got to launch higher for you to be able to maximise carry distance, which we'll come back to a little bit later on. But all in, that's the 85 mile an hour driver swing speed. Let's move on and let's have a look at the 100. All right, 100 mile an hour swing speed with the driver. Where do we start here? Well, I'd say there's 6.3 yards between the longest and the shortest shot. So now it's becoming more important about which golf ball you choose to play with the driver, because there's more to be lost at this swing speed than what there is at slower speeds. No surprise at all, the fastest golf balls are the firmest golf balls. So we've got the Maxfli-Tour-X tied first, the Wilson Staff model tied first, and also the Callaway-Chrome-Soft-X as well. Just looking at the shot area, this becomes quite interesting, because the Callaway-Chrome-Soft-XLS is our tightest dispersion ball, really aimed at being a long, straight, accurate golf ball, as long as you've got plenty of speed to be able to launch it. Just keep an eye on the Wilson, because the Wilson Staff model here, this isn't the only time that it makes an appearance right at the top of our charts, and also on the Maxfli-Tour-X as well, because that will be popping up at a number of different occasions as we wind through this review. As I said before, just down here in red, you've got the test average at 241 yards. So anything above there is above average, and anything below there is below average. But like I've already said, there's only 6.3 yards here between the longest and the shortest ball. Let's have a look at 115 miles an hour with the driver. Right, 115 miles an hour with the driver, that's pretty quick. Which balls are bubbling away at the top of our chart? Well, again, we've got the Maxfli-Tour-X as our longest golf ball, Wilson Staff model, and then we've got the Callaway-Chrome-Soft-XLS. Now, they are three firmer golf balls, so it's absolutely no surprise at all that the firmest golf balls are also the fastest golf balls. What I would say with this is there's now 11.9 yards between the longest golf ball and the shortest, and that becomes quite a lot. You know, if you're really looking at optimizing driver distance, then you can lose a huge amount off the tee by choosing the wrong golf ball here. What are the lowest to the highest spinning golf balls? Well, if we look over here, lowest is at 1910 RPM. So the Super Soft from Callaway, which we've also seen as a very low spin golf ball at slower speeds. And then the highest spinning golf ball, so the Kirkland Signature Plus. If you've got any sort of speed at all, what we've noticed throughout these tests is that the Kirkland is a very, very high spin ball. So if you put a premium on distance, this probably isn't going to be the model that really suits you. What I would say again, I've already mentioned it, but keep an eye on the Maxfli-Tour-X. It bubbles away there at the top of our charts a lot, as does the Wilson Staff, and as does the Callaway-Chrome-Soft-X. So loads of information there. Let's have a look at how the numbers compare when we average them out across all three driver swing speeds. Okay, so we've looked at individual driver data, but I prefer to average them across all three swing speeds, because that gives you a much better idea about how the golf ball is going to really play out there on the golf course for everybody that uses it. Just starting off here, we've got 5 yards from longest to shortest golf ball when we look at the 85 miles an hour, 100 miles an hour, and 115 mile an hour speeds. The average shot area is 71.8 square yards, so that's actually pretty big. And plotting those onto this graph, so using the test average, for carry distance here, is 241.8 yards. So anything this side of the line is above average. Anything below that is below average on the right-hand side there. And then looking at shot area. So we've got 1, 2, and 3 here in the red numbers. Number 1 represents the Wilson Triad. So very accurate golf ball with the driver. And watch what happens when we use it with the iron and the wedge as well. Number 2, Wilson Staff model. So Wilson's got 2 balls there at the top, which are very accurate models. And then moving on to number 3, the Maxfli-Tour-X, which again is bubbling away there at the top of the charts. Winding this forward to lowest to highest driver spin. Now we hear A lot of golfers say, I just want to get the lowest spin driver ball because then I can hit it the furthest. And we sort of agree with that at higher speeds. But if you, as I've already mentioned, if you're at a lower speed, be very, very careful about playing the very lowest spin golf ball out there. If you're drawn to tour balls and you're looking for the lowest spin golf ball, then we've got the lowest spin tour ball here, which is the Callaway-Chrome-Soft-X-LS. And if you're really looking to cut driver spin, obviously you want to stay away from the balls that are over there on the far hand side. So that's your PXG, your Kirkland, your 1080 P5 and your the Srixon Dead Star Diamond. But all in, this gives you a really, really good idea about which golf ball might suit your game, your driver game, based on spin. And if you're at the lowest end of speed, I'd stay a little bit away from this very low end here. But once you're getting to 89, 90 miles an hour, then you should be absolutely fine with a lower spin golf ball. Winding it on to cost per yard. Now, this just puts it into reality about how much difference there is in the cost of golf balls out there. So over here on the left-hand side, we've got the Pinnacle Rush and we've got the Kirkland Signature Plus at 7 pence a yard. Whereas over here on the right-hand side, we've got the Titleist, so the Pro V1, the Pro V1X, the Tellamy TP5, TP5X, the Callaways. Obviously, there's a massive, massive difference there. But if you're looking for the least expensive tour ball, then you'll be looking here at the Wilson Staff at 18 pence per yard. So hopefully that's going to help you narrow down. You know, if you set yourself a budget and that's how much you're going to spend on golf balls, this will give you a ballpark figure about where you should be looking. If you don't mind paying for the tour balls, absolutely fill your boots over here. And if you're looking for the least expensive tour ball, obviously that Wilson Staff model is a great option over here. And then if you really want to buy the cheapest golf balls that you can because you lose a lot on the golf course, then obviously these models over here would be a great choice. Right, that's loads about drivers. Let's move this on. Let's have a look at irons. On to the 7-iron. Where do we start? Well, let's start by saying that from longest to shortest, there's nearly 6 yards worth of difference here. So when you put that in conjunction with the difference in the drivers, you're starting to see, you know, the balls that are rising to the top and the balls that are starting to sink towards the bottom. So, you know, for most people, that 6 yards really could be half a club. So really worthwhile looking at which balls, you know, suit your budget, suit your game with the iron and the wedge. Fastest, looking down here, Maxfli-Tour. So again, that Maxfli name is there, just bubbling away, just winding this forward. So tied second, you've got the Callaway Chrome Soft X and the TaylorMade TP5. So very, very fast golf balls there. What stands out to me, again, is 3 of the top 5 longest Callaway golf balls. So the Callaway ERC Soft, the Callaway Super Soft, the Callaway Chrome Soft. So these are balls that keep appearing and appearing and appearing again. Most accurate, just looking over there on the far side. So number one, the Callaway ERC Soft in a tiny, tiny little area. It's less than 3 square yards. But when you're hit by a robot, that's what you can actually do. Moving on to the second and the third, tightest accuracy. You've got the TaylorMade TP5 and then the TaylorMade TP5X. So if you're looking at speed and distance along with accuracy with irons, then obviously both those balls would be a really, really good choice. Looking at the lowest spin, obviously that when you're playing irons into a green from distance, you want the ball to be able to land and stop. You do not want it just bouncing on and bouncing on. So the Bridgestone, the E6, is the lowest spin with an iron. So be a bit wary about using that one, especially at lower speeds. And then the highest spin with the 7-iron, the PXG Extreme, which you'll also see with the wedges in a minute when we talk about them. So winding this forward onto peak height and this descent angle, these are two things that are becoming more and more important when it comes to fitting, especially if you're using distance irons or strong lofted irons. It's really important to be able to flight the golf ball to hit the green at a steep descent angle so that shots actually stop. So this graph basically shows the angle at which the ball is coming down on this side and then the height for each of the golf balls over here. And absolutely no surprise at all that when we look over here, the two highest flying golf balls, they are two-piece golf balls. And that tells you a huge amount about how two-piece golf balls are playable on the golf course. As long as you've got a little bit of speed, they launch high, they fly high, and they hit the green at a steep descent angle as well. Moving on to what's the highest tour ball, okay, and the steepest descent angle for a tour ball. Well, the steepest descent angle will be the Wilson Staff model, and then the highest flying golf ball will be the Callaway-Chrome-Soft-X-LS. So hopefully you can start to see that you've got both the tightest over here, which are coming in at a lower angle. It just gives you an idea about how they are going to launch into the air compared to some of the other balls. A slightly lower window, which obviously some very decent players really, really enjoy. Okay, that's the 7-iron. Let's have a look at the wedge. Right, wedge. Just remember, this is the full shot with the wedge, and the backspin numbers really talk for themselves. I really don't need to say too much here. We do hear loads of golfers when we speak to them that just go, okay, I want to play with the highest wedge spin ball that I can get my hands on. And lots of people will just choose the Pro V1 just for that particular reason. But this chart will show you that's probably not the best idea that you can come up with. Again, in the red, this is the test average. So anything above that is above average. Anything below that is below average. What really stands out to me, well, just winding the clock back here, the shot area, so the Bridgestone, the Torby RX, is incredibly small, 2.5 square yards, which is nothing. That steps up to 4.3 yards, square yards with the Srixon Z Star, and then up to 4.8 square yards with the Srixon Z Star XV. So again, you've got Srixon bubbling away there for really good accuracy numbers. What's the highest spinning wedge ball? Well, let's wind it forward to this chart here. This puts it into really easily understandable numbers. So the PXG Extreme, so 8,183 RPM. Then next is the Srixon, so the Z-Star Diamond. Next, the TaylorMade TP5. But Kirkland, so the signature ball, is very high as well, so 7,985. So I think winding the clock back to when we were speaking about 85 mile an hour swing speeds with the driver, you could essentially give up virtually nothing with the driver with the Kirkland. Yes, okay, it's sort of 4 yards shorter or 5 yards shorter than the longest ball, but that's virtually nothing. If you're looking for maximum wedge spin, maximum control, then actually, rather than choosing a two-piece golf ball, the Kirkland is a very good option because it's so high spin, but at very high swing speeds, it really wouldn't be a very good idea because you're starting to lose a lot of distance. What I would say is to just take a look at some of the numbers over there on the far right hand side, because they are low spin golf balls with the wedge, which you might not expect. So the TaylorMade, the Tour Response, the Bridgestone Torby, RXS, and the Srixon, the Q-Star Tour, all golf balls that are aimed at club golfers. Really important to understand that this is full wedge spin. This is not greenside wedge spin. So all of those balls over there, they have got a urethane cover. So control from the green side is likely still to be really, really good. Okay, loads of information there. I'm not quite finished because I haven't included the highest spinning two-piece golf ball, so the Pinnacle Rush. We've always been told that two-piece golf balls can never spin. We saw from our previous test that that isn't the case at all. And if you're looking for wedge spin, but you only want to buy a two-piece golf ball, which is the cheapest on the market, then the Pinnacle Rush would be an excellent option. Let's move this forward. Let's have a look at how the different constructions of golf balls compare. At the start of this video, we promised to help you choose the best golf ball for your game, and this is a brilliant slide to help you do that. Just knowing the differences between each of the different constructions, with the driver, with the iron, with the wedge, should help you choose which area, which construction might best suit your game, but also your budget as well. So if we start off with the driver here at the top, the four-piece golf ball, so the four-piece tour, is the longest with the driver. It's also the fastest with the driver, but it's also the firmest. So there will be people out there that go, okay, that's too firm for when I'm putting. I don't like the feel of it. Whereas two-piece, so the two-piece over here, is the shortest with the driver, but it's also the lowest spin with the driver. So that basically means that is where the driver distance comes from, because it's so low spin. Moving on to the 7-iron. So the two-piece golf ball is now the longest, but the lowest spin. And that's the bit that I'd be a little bit concerned about. It's the lowest spin. But also, it's highest and has the joint steepest descent angle of any of the golf balls here that we've tested. So that's where the playability comes from. As long as you have a reasonable level of speed to be able to launch shots sort of high enough, spin them enough to be able to stop shots on the green. Onto the three-piece tour balls here. So they are higher spin with the 7-iron than what the two-piece golf balls are. So this is where they fit into the equation. You hit a lot more iron shots into greens than what you will do with wedges. And also because the three-piece club golf or golf balls have got a urethane cover, they're going to spin more from green side as well than what you would get with the two-piece golf balls. If you really want iron spin, then the five-piece, so the tailor-made golf balls, they are the highest spinning with the 7-iron. Just moving on to the wedge. Again, the five-piece golf balls are the highest spinning with a wedge. So if spin is really important to your game, whether it's being able to shape shots or being able to stop shots once they hit the green, that's a really, really good choice. The three-piece tour and the four-piece tour are very evenly matched with the wedge. So you can't really choose between them. And also with the wedge, the two-piece and the three-piece club golfer balls are very evenly matched as well. So based on where you want to put an emphasis within your own game, hopefully, just looking at the categories, the golf ball construction categories, you'll be able to decide from this where you want to start looking at buying your next sleeve of golf balls from. The most accurate golf ball. Well, it's not something that we really covered off in the 2019 robot test that we did. But because we've looked at shot area for each of the five different situations that we've tested from, we're able to now show you about the most accurate golf balls that we've hit. I probably really should just say that the test average is at 31.2 square yards. So all of these are below average, whereas the ones that I'll show you in a minute, they're above average. But don't think that the golf balls that have got the widest average are the poorest golf balls, because that isn't true either. A number of these models are actually made to be slightly more workable, so you'd expect them to go into a slightly wider area. But looking at the best performers, you know, the golf balls that gave us the smallest shot area, and the results are pretty incredible. So Wilson Triad is the most accurate golf ball that we hit, going into just over 17 square yards. The Wilson Staff model was next, and then the Kirkland, so the Signature Plus, 21 square yards. But what's really interesting to me, and what makes this one of the most interesting slides in the whole test, is that each of the three different categories that we've actually tested over, and we're going to make recommendations on, Wilson completely cover off each of them. So the Wilson Triad, best, most accurate club golfer golf ball. The Wilson Staff model, the most accurate tour ball that we hit. And then in the two-piece golf balls that we've looked at, Wilson, they have got the most accurate two-piece ball there as well. So really interesting results. And what I'd say, if you're on the borderline between this golf ball and this golf ball, this is a really good slide to help you choose which one's going to best suit your game. Okay, we've spoken about best performing golf balls lots. Let's have a look at our top performing tour golf balls. We've looked at all of that test data, and we've tried to come up with our top three performing golf balls for the tour level models. And these are the three that we've picked. I should really start off by saying these are all on the firmer side of the golf balls that we've tested. The Staff model only comes in one model. There's not a firmer style ball to it. But the X, so the TP5X and the Callaway-Chrome-Soft-X, they are pretty firm golf balls, and there's less firm models out there that you could choose. If we start in the middle, for me, the Wilson Staff model is an absolutely fantastic golf ball. Not only was it the most accurate tour ball that we tested, it was also the least expensive tour ball that we tested, and it was bubbling away there at the top of our charts a number of times. It was the longest tour ball, averaged over 100 and 115 miles an hour with the driver and with the 7-iron. So if distance is your thing, then this is a great golf ball to choose, and obviously is very friendly on your pocket as well. Moving on to the Callaway Chrome Soft. Now, you can see there's a price difference here. So they are slightly more expensive, but it's a fast, long golf ball off the tee again. And we really liked that not only is it fast and long off the tee, but it's the third highest tour level wedge spin ball. So not only are you getting that distance, you're getting the wedge spin as well. It was the fifth most accurate tour ball. So, not the most accurate because it's designed to be workable and shapeable. So if that's your thing, then this would be a very, very good option. Moving over to the TaylorMade TP5X, and I completely appreciate that there's plenty of people out there that could make an argument to say that the Titleist Pro V1X or the Srixon Z-Star Diamonds should be in here instead. And I'd completely understand any argument that you really want to make on that front. I've specifically picked the TP5X because it's longer than the Z-Star Diamond when averaged over 115 and the 7-iron. So it's a fast and long golf ball. It gives up 348 RPM of wedge spin against the Z-Star Diamond, but it gives a tighter shot area than the Titleist Pro V1X. So there's a combination of things there, which I would probably put that above the other two balls, but I completely appreciate it's a very, very tight call, and I don't think you can make the wrong call by going for any of those three models. The other ball that I haven't really touched on here is the Maxfli-Tour-X. Now, we've seen that bubbling away at the top of our charts a number of times, and I could completely appreciate anybody saying, well, why is that not in there? That should be in there as one of those picks. Basically, the Tour-X, it's not played on tour, so it's not really a tour ball, but it would make a fantastic alternative to any of these three balls. And obviously it's less expensive than all of these three as well. And the other reason why we haven't put it amongst these golf balls is because if you're lucky enough to live in the US, then you can buy the Maxfli golf balls. Here in the UK, we're not able to. We're not even able to have a look at the Dick's Sporting Goods website. So when we went on to Amazon to see how much they were going to charge us to ship some to the UK, it's over £52 a dozen. So at that price, I think there's better options here. But if you live in the USA, Maxfli-Tour-X, I think, is a fantastic golf ball. Okay, that's the top performing tour golf balls. Let's move on. Let's have a look at the club golfer models. Okay, so you're an average club golfer. You swing the golf club maybe at 90 miles an hour, 92, 93 miles an hour. Which are the top performing golf balls for you? Well, these would be our pick. Starting in the middle, Wilson Staff Triad. What a golf ball. It's our most accurate golf ball. Wilson always said that this is a golf ball that's aimed at people that are happy with how far they already hit it. So if distance is your number one priority when you're buying golf balls, this probably isn't quite the right golf ball for you, because even though it's most accurate, it's not the longest and it's not the fastest. But if accuracy is where you want to stack things in your favour, what a brilliant option. Moving over to the Callaway ERC Soft. Now, this is a long golf ball. As long as you've got a reasonable level of speed to launch it, this is a very, very good option. One thing that stands out to me is that it's the least amount of iron spin when we compare it to the TaylorMade Tour Response, the Wilson Triad, and the Srixon Q-Star Tour, and also the Chrome Soft. So about 12.8% less than our test average, which would be the the only little area where I go, oh, I hit a lot of iron shots and I really need to make sure, you know, that shots stop on the green. Now, to be fair to Callaway, this model does fly higher and it does have a steeper descent, so it can fit moderate speed players. Just be aware that it was the lowest iron spin ball in this particular category, but it had the most amount of wedge spin. So it's almost like you're juggling, trying to decide, where should I go with this? In my way of thinking, I think it's a fantastic golf ball, especially with the new alignment graphics on it as well. Moving over to the Q-Star Tour. So it's not the fastest or longest. And I think that's a really important thing to sort of just cover off for club golfers. Yes, of course, we want to hit the golf ball as far as we can do. But at the end of the day, if you're giving up such small levels of speed or distance, then I'd be very keen to make sure that my iron spin doesn't duck below 5,000 with a 7 iron, so 5,000 RPM. It didn't with the Q-Star Tour. You know, so if your game is based around hitting iron shots as, you know, as close as you possibly can do to get it to land and stop, on a sixpence, this is a fantastic golf ball for doing it. It's also really good accuracy with the 7 iron and wedge, which is the area, you know, that a lot of club golfers would want their accuracy with. As I said in the previous slide, if you live in the USA and you've got the opportunity of buying the Maxfli-Tour-X, then I think that's a fantastic golf ball to compare against these models. Obviously, here in the UK, we can't buy that particular model, but just be aware, it will have a firmer feel than all three of these different models. Right, let's move this forward. Let's have a look at the best two-piece golf balls on the market. Okay, the two-piece category. We know that a lot of golf balls are bought within this category because most club golfers are prone to losing golf balls, and this is what they turn to. If we start off with the Srixon AD333, and I know back in 2019, this is one of our top performing golf balls, and it feels like it still is. It's a really, really good option. It's not the fastest, not the longest with the driver or the 7-iron, but it's the highest spin two-piece golf ball with the 7-iron, which is more spin than a Pro V1. And just show me a club golfer that wouldn't want that. I really like the way that it gives you more height, steeper descent angle than the test average. And it's really good at less than average speed. So it's not the lowest spinning golf ball on the market. The other models that we test, you know, which are very, very low spin, yes, they can be long, but if you can't launch them to a decent height, then you're not going to be able to score on the golf course with them. So to me, that feels like a very, very strong option. If we look at the Wilson DuoSoft on the opposite end of that scale, really, it's consistently less than average spin. Okay, so you're going to need reasonable levels of speed to be able to play with this model, in my opinion. 13.4% less spin at 100 miles an hour and 12.9% less spin with a 7-iron. So if my game's aimed at hitting iron shots as close as I possibly can do, as much as it's a good golf ball, I really do feel like you're going to need, you know, decent levels of speed to be able to get the best out of it. It was the third highest wedge spin in the two-piece category and eighth most accurate golf ball overall. So if you have got speed, a very, very good option, which is not going to leave a hole in your wallet. Moving over to the Pinnacle Rush, and goodness me, I've worked in golf for many, many years, and Pinnacle have a name for being very long, very hard, and golf balls that don't spin. Well, this was the highest wedge spin golf ball for a two-piece model. So, it's a very cheap golf ball. It would make a very, very good option if you're prone to losing quite a few golf balls out there and you just want the cheapest golf ball that you can get your hands on. The only thing that I would say is the Kirkland. If your swing speed is very, very average and you want iron spin, you want wedge spin, then the Kirkland at a similar price would be an excellent option for you because you will get more control around the green side and in the short game. Right, loads of information there. Let's finally have a look at what we've actually learnt. We've spent hours and hours and hours planning, executing, and creating content around this golf balls test. But what have we actually learnt out of it? Well, there's six things that really stand out to me personally. So starting off on number one, it's time to look again at club golfer focused golf balls if you are a club golfer. And when I say club golfer golf balls, I'm talking the Wilson triad. So if you've been playing a Titleist Pro V1 for year after year after year and you've never switched golf ball, the Wilson triad is inseparable compared to the Titleist Pro V1 across all metrics, yet it's 92 pence a golf ball cheaper, and it's all it's more accurate as well. So name me a golfer that wouldn't want those traits. Moving on to number two, rethink which Titleist Pro V1 you use. Well, the Pro V1 family, they've changed a huge amount over the last few years. And if you've just played the Pro V1 blindly, now is the time to stop, rethink, and try the Pro V1X as well. The Pro V1X is it's higher spinning with the iron, it's higher spinning with the wedge. And we hear so many golfers that say, I just play the Titleist Pro V1 because it gives me the most amount of wedge spin. That isn't the case anymore. So take this opportunity to go and explore the Pro V1X. Moving on to Maxfli. They can seriously cut your golf ball budget. And hands up, if we lived in the USA, then we'd be all over the Maxfli-Tour-X. It looks like a fantastic golf ball across the board. Unfortunately, we don't live in the US, and we're not able to buy that particular golf ball here in the UK. But if you're lucky enough to live in the USA, then please, you know, go and try the Maxfli-Tour-X, because it does seem like a very, very good golf ball, and you can seriously cut your golf ball budget by doing so. Soft golf balls aren't short golf balls. We've heard so many times soft golf balls are slow golf balls. Okay, they might be, especially when they're not played by their intended audience. But our data shows again, soft golf balls are not short golf balls. In fact, they were the four longest golf balls with the driver and with the iron as well. So if you really do like a soft feeling golf ball, then you're doing nothing wrong by playing the softest models that you can find. Especially if your swing speed is below, I'd say, 95 miles an hour. Once you get above that, then you might start to experience, you know, some other golf balls going further, spinning more and being a better option. Number five, two-piece golf balls, they can spin. And who would have thought that a Pinnacle Rush could spin more than a Titleist Pro V1? That just doesn't compute for virtually anybody. You don't have to play a a urethane covered golf ball to get the really good wedge spin. You can do that with the Srixon AD333 or the Pinnacle Rush. But just be aware that full wedge spin is not greenside spin. So if you're attracted to the two-piece market and you're looking for the highest spin wedge ball, I'd seriously urge you to buy a few, go and give them a test around the green. How do they feel, especially on the shortest shots and from sand as well? And then last but not least, X-style golf balls, if you're looking within the tour level category, they're an absolute no-brainer in my opinion. They're faster, they're longer, and they tend to spin more with a wedge, which is pretty much what most golfers want. And when you look out there on tour, that's a trend that's being followed out there as well. So unless you specifically want a softer feeling tour level golf ball, or you're trying to shape shots, I would say that the X-style balls are an absolutely fantastic option. Right, that's it. That's the end of the video. If you've liked the video, hit the like and subscribe button. If you've got any comments or questions, leave them below, and we promise to answer every single sensible one. We'll see you next time.